For the past 3 weeks, I was in the United States and Japan having conversations. I did something similar 6 months ago, and now here I am, back at it again. We're coming up on the second anniversary of ChatGPT, and the beginning of the modern AI boom. History is being made here, and I wanted to dive into the heart of it. It was also another excuse to share some travel pics. In this video, a few thoughts and observations, hastily written and edited in a plane. This video is brought to you by the Asianometry Patreon. It's one of the better ways to support the channel, blah blah blah, early access. Thanks, and on with the show. The original reason for my trip was a semiconductor design conference called Hot Chips. Hot Chips is a humble conference held at Stanford, should be held at Berkeley, but whatever. It's not like a traditional conference per se, but rather a series of presentations in an auditorium. You can attend either via video or in person. I chose to go in person for some reason. As it turns out, I did not actually watch many of the presentations in person. I ended up having many one-on-one conversations with individuals, thanks to those who recognized me and stopped me to say hi, or just fell asleep thanks to jet lag. If you want an excellent overview and very opinionated stack ranking of the presentations, I direct you to the Substack Irrational Analysis. This is a new newsletter, but it is written by an individual in the chip design industry who I know personally. You want opinions? Oh boy, they have opinions. My general takeaway? Meta and Tesla are making good progress in designing cheap ASICs for very specific AI applications. They do exactly what they do and are super lean. Also, there's a new optical packaging technology out there called co-packaging optics, or CPO, which is probably the future of how we send data between different chips. Things like transceivers are probably a declining technology now. The big headlining companies like AMD and OpenAI did not present much new things, but of course, you probably should have not expected as such. In my last video about the AI boom, the big question I was thinking about was whether or not there were LLM-based applications out there making money. The financial issue of finding a return for all the billions being spent on infrastructure was so elegantly presented in an analysis written by Sequoia's David Kahn titled The $600 Billion Question. I tried to reach out to Mr. David, but he never responded to my email. David, I'd love to say hi next time I'm in town. Anyway, in that video, I also talked about how people in the industry were looking at Microsoft's big upcoming OpenAI-powered Copilot products. So where are we now? So far, the answer is a bit mixed. To me, it is apparent that Copilot has not set the world on fire. Revenue-wise, my uneducated guess is that all the Microsoft Copilots are probably making somewhere like $1 billion annualized. For Microsoft, that is not good enough, but they're not giving up. They recently scheduled a future rebranding of the product, and people are already starting to make jokes about it. So it's been 2 years since, and we don't yet have a challenger revenue-wise to ChatGPT. Yet at the same time, we definitely have companies out there making money, up to tens of millions of dollars of revenue even. Who are the largest companies in the industry other than ChatGPT and OpenAI? Revenue-wise, it's probably 11 Labs out in New York City. They do voice generation stuff and is probably making $100 million or so in revenue. But if you're looking at it in terms of usage, that's probably Character.ai, the chatbot company that recently licensed its models and I guess quote-unquote sold part of its team, including its co-founder, over to Google. Usage at the company seems to be through the roof. The problem is that their core users are teenagers with no money, and running AI models is expensive. These costs are probably why they laid people off recently. There are plenty of startups with strong product market fit. The strongest fits are the ones that leverage the LLM AI's core advantages rather than trying to swap out the quote-unquote human for AI, because everyone seems to acknowledge that it's not there yet. The most promising companies are the ones that help workers save time, especially when handling huge bunches of information, either in text or audio form. I think Google has it right when they show these demos of their Gemini AI parsing through 75-page service agreements and the like. In this demo, they give Gemini two documents and ask questions about the content inside said documents. Seems right up the LLM's alley. Or Cursor AI, that text editor application that helps developers write better code. The LLM reads the code base or something like that. LLMs also seem to be quite good at doing your paperwork, admin tasks, or customer service slash order taking. I am particularly struck by the idea of LLMs taking orders at drive-thrus. Not here yet, but feels like something the big fast food companies will eventually crack down the line. A story I have not heard too much about has been the ongoing price war in LLM API tokens. According to the DeepLearning.ai batch newsletter, the original GPT-4 API released in March 2023 cost about $36 per million tokens. As of this writing in September 2024, a million GPT-4o tokens cost about $4. So, over the past 17 months, API prices have seen 9 times reduction or 80% reduction per year. This trend appears to be due to improvements in software and how to better use existing resources rather than more advanced semiconductors. Most of it has occurred during the same generation of Nvidia GPUs. This trend has made a few people cite Moore's Law. I can see the connection, sort of, but there's another silicon-related historical incident that I think fits better. Bob Noyce at Fairchild Semiconductor. As Fairchild got better at producing transistors and integrated circuits, Bob Noyce cut prices on their planar transistors from $5 to 25 cents, and ICs from $20 to $2. Such price cuts help make other products like transistor radios more affordable to the public. Will the API price crash do the same here? I still have latent uncertainties about whether it is possible that a whole company can run on top of just a few bits of fine-tuning data and some AI APIs, but let the market handle that. The main issue with continued growth in the AI ecosystem is their quote-unquote intelligence. In other words, the foundation models that they all rely upon. It is widely acknowledged by people both inside and outside the industry that, though we have found a few good and somewhat profitable end-user applications, the GPT-4 foundation model and its cohorts are on the whole still very limited. Thus, we all turn to the next generation, or GPT-5. That is what literally everyone in the industry is talking about right now. I'm struck by how even people at other leading AI research labs talk about OpenAI like as if it were a black box. They're a silent force moving through the valley. So we all wait for OpenAI, parsing the $100 billion startup's every move and word for clues. It's like as if we are in the IBM PC era again, when IBM defined the standard and all the PC clone makers are only following. Everyone is looking to IBM to tell us where to go next, that the next step is even possible. Of course, if we follow the historical metaphor to its conclusion, IBM was a king with no clothes, and other companies in the once IBM-defined standard needed to step up and take that step forward to move beyond them. But who will do that? There are a few companies trying new approaches to building without scaling, Sakana AI in Japan and Safe Super Intelligence being two such startups raising money. But the Bay Area is quote-unquote scale-pilled, as they like to say it, and continuing the scaling will require immense financial and material resources, and only a few tech giants can afford that. From those tech giants, I hear that there are indications of strain, a growing realization that the capital expenditure numbers people are throwing around are getting to be a little too much. But right now for these tech giants, it's a game of chicken. The giants need to spend tens of billions of dollars on this AI thing, at least for the next few years, because they think the costs of sitting it out and seeing someone else possibly take the crown are unacceptable. But who will be the last to stop? I visited on the week of Nvidia earnings, so basically that week. They were the most important company in the world. I got to visit the campus, ate a salad at their cafeteria, my god I love salads, and bought a pair of Nvidia socks from their gift shop. I will treasure them as I jog through Taipei. The current ranking in the AI chip industry is as follows. First, Nvidia by a mile, then after that, AMD. That is basically it in terms of AI accelerators you can buy. Nvidia's future dominance in this market, barring any serious government intervention or meteors hitting Jensen Huang's house, feels to be largely dependent on a few things. First, will one of the tech giants' AI chips emerge as a major player in the market? We should mention the Amazon AWS chips, but the Google TPU is the obvious thing to think about here. But in classic Google fashion, the TPU feels simultaneously impressive and underutilized. Despite being a majestic piece of technology and an incredible edge, it is also largely just seen as infrastructure. Google sees and treats it as part of the other things they're doing, Google Cloud, Gemini, etc. Side note, I'm exploring to see if I can do a video on the history of the TPU If you know anything about that, like if you used to work on that team and want to say hi, email me, john@asianometry.com. Second, we need one of the current chip startups to break out. This to me seems maybe not impossible, but at least unlikely. Perhaps it was because it was hot chips, but there seemed to be literally dozens of fabless AI chip startups running around. There was a guy at the show with a list of 55 plus such startups. Each of these AI chip startups has a shtick covering virtually the whole spectrum of the curve: specialization, power, performance, so on. The core issue for all these companies is that semiconductors are not like the ride-sharing or Uber for whatever go-go era. You can't rapidly spin up a website, get a bunch of people off the street, and scale. You need to design a chip, fab it over 5 to 6 months, and then somehow figure out a way to sell it. Anything can happen in even just 6 months, but it looks like to me that many of these AI chip startups will fail. Maybe just 3 or 4 get sold at cost to an existing player as an acquihire. To avoid this fate, they need to work harder than they ever have before. At the time of my visit, the third most biggest talk of the town was Intel. The company had recently announced a disastrous quarter and the stock crashed something like 30%. Naturally, the internet is full of memes, especially because some guy on Reddit apparently bet something like 700k of his grandma's money on Intel right before the earnings report. People are picking over this company so much that I have nothing new to say. The news is concerning. It always is when the stock drops 30% in a day. There is a big board meeting in mid-September with a variety of options on the table, such as capital expenditure cuts and business divestments. Everyone seems to have an opinion on whether or not Intel should split up like AMD did a decade plus before. Some say a split cannot be avoided. Others say that it would be a premature birth. Looking back at the AMD Global Foundry spinoff, we had Abu Dhabi putting billions of dollars into the latter company to fund continued capital expenditures. This at a time when semiconductor nodes cost far less. Who has enough money for Intel now? Doug O'Loughlin of Fabricated Knowledge has the best take that I have seen. Feel free to pause the video to read it. In the end though, I don't think Intel's people will go for Doug's plan. It's too bold. Heavily dependent on execution, fancy word for saying it's hard, and also really dependent on what regulators will say. And semiconductors, nowadays being so politicized, things probably will just stay the same. Intel will probably just stay the course for a few more years, waiting for the next generation process nodes to hit the market. 18A picks up a few nibblers who want alternatives, and if that all goes well, then the customers and the revenue really pours in with 14A. Both nodes are supposedly good, at least that is what I keep hearing from people. They're definitely innovative, but what if they're not good? There's so much pressure, and I just keep wondering if they have the wafer volume that TSMC uses to iron out the kinks for high volume. If the nodes are not good, what then? The 18A/14A savior scenario is supposed to play out in 2027, 2028 or something like that. That's a long time for Intel to muddle through, and a lot of money for them to raise. Where will it come from if AMD and Nvidia continue to take a sledgehammer to their x86 business? I suppose this is where I have to mention CHIPS Act Part 2. People seem infinitely confident that it will happen in some form or function, basically for years now. But how much money will it be giving out? This is unclear. Bonus before we close, the underrated tech story of my trip has been Waymo. My last trip to SF, Waymo was still an exclusive thing. You saw them occasionally, but only a few selected invited riders can go in them. Now, they are everywhere. For years, we have dreamed of riding in a car that drives itself. Now we have it. It is here. And everyone in San Francisco and Los Angeles is treating them like the pigeons on the street. A nuisance. Why are we not freaking out every time a Waymo pulls up next to us and there is no driver in the seat? There is no question that Waymo won the autonomous vehicle wars. People might want to snark that is because of Google's money, certainly had something to do with it, but there's something striking to me about how Google approached this. Rather than sashaying around trying to find some elegant engineering design solution, they realized that they were going to have to do hard, seemingly unscalable things. They mapped the roads, built a powerful data collection apparatus to identify the best performing driving models, set up depots, and equipped a ride-sharing service. This was brute force, and it worked. I want to point you guys to the writings of Kevin Chen, who used to work in the industry. I'm struck by the depth of his understanding of this Waymo rollout on every level, from technical to business to operations. I highly recommend his YouTube channel too. We are all learning new things about what it means to have self-driving cars on our roads, including the actual economics of running such a business. They're not as flowery as you might think. Back to the question at the top of this video: where are we going? To me, it all comes down to the next generation of foundation models. Just like how two guys near a tree sat around waiting for Godot, we wait for GPT-5. We wait so long such that attention within the industry and the financial analysts has moved from the AI models and even the chips inside them to the data centers themselves. Everyone is talking about bigger and bigger data centers. SemiAnalysis is selling a data center model now, and the fact that Dylan thinks it might be bigger than the AI accelerator model is indicative of the notion. Anyways, the work is already laid for the next 2 years of scaling. After that, who knows? What can the scaling laws do with 2 more years? Let us see how things are during my next trip to the United States. Expect another video report then too. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.